Justice Kennedy. He's the one that they're afraid of bringing a pro-life case before. We know what the other four are. He's the swing vote. Justice Ginsburg continues. And most troubling, Casey's principles confirming the continued vitality of the essential holding of Roe are merely assumed for the moment rather than retained or reaffirmed. She goes on to say, though today's opinion does not go so far as to discard Roe or Casey, the court, differently composed than it was when we last considered a restrictive abortion regulation, is hardly faithful to our earlier invocations of the rule of law and the principles of stare decisis. The hair is standing on the back of her neck. The hair is standing on the back of the necks of the ACLU, Planned Parenthood, NARAL, and all the others. What are we so afraid of? This is the court that has to hear a case challenging Roe now, before something happens to Kennedy, before something happens to Scalia or any of the others, and President Obama puts another justice on. I can tell you one thing the Democrats are very good about. They're very good about selecting justices. They never make a mistake. There's never a stealth justice that makes it on the bench who's not a strongly pro-abort. Republicans aren't necessarily that good at it. Look at the makeup of this court. The other thing to think about Justice Kennedy, there's no doubt he's seeing all the, you know, hundreds of thousands of people who are going to be marching tomorrow. One thing is for certain, the Roe versus Wade decision has corrupt our judiciary. It has absolutely corrupted our judiciary. Because now every judicial nominee of any significance, the litmus test always is abortion. Not whether or not they're a good jurist, whether or not they're thoughtful in their decisions, whether they're fair in their decisions. The question is, where do they come out on Roe versus Wade? And don't think the justices don't realize that. Here's an opportunity for Justice Kennedy in the twilight of his career, hopefully his conscience speaking very loudly to him, that not only is Roe v. Wade, does it not have any founding or support in the Constitution, but it's corrupted the very body that I work with, the judicial system. No doubt about it, the Bork and Thomas debacles were all about abortion, nothing else. Now is the time. Now is the time to bring it to the U.S. Supreme Court. Here's some of the additional criticisms, I call them non-criticisms, that I hear mostly from people in the pro-life community. If we bring a case up to the Supreme Court right now, they're going to establish a super abortion right, because Justice Ginsburg's view of the law is that, well, case Roe versus Wade, and even the legal scholars who are in favor of abortion realize that it wasn't a very well done decision, in terms of having any basis in the law, but she would decide the case under the Equal Protection Clause. And she would do so that we can strike down all these laws that place restrictions on funding of abortion and so forth. So the concern from the critics is, well, look, if we bring a case up to the Supreme Court, we're going to have this now, this super abortion right created under the Equal Protection Clause. Well, why wasn't that the concern when the partial birth abortion case was going through? And at the time, you had O'Connor on the bench. You had a worse makeup of the court then. And the reality is, and these lawyers know it, that when you have a fractured opinion, it's the narrowest grounds for the upholding of that opinion. So if you have Justice Kennedy, for example, saying, well, you know what, I know where I am on this, but I don't think I'm going to overturn Roe. I mean, this is, to me, worst-case scenario. He's going to write an opinion that's similar to Casey. He's not going to all of a sudden go from what I just read you, where he wrote in Gonzales, to now falling all the way over in the other camp to create a super abortion right that has even greater restrictions than what Roe v. Wade establishes. That's just nonsense. But those are the criticisms. It's one of the main criticisms, other than the timing. Repeal of abortion restrictions by implication. They say, well, look, if you pass this personhood amendment, it's going to repeal all these great regulations that we've established, and then we're going to go back, and then once it gets struck down, all those laws are now off the books. Well, this isn't a serious objection. Courts look extremely disfavorably at this notion of repeal by implication, and if the amendment is in fact enjoined, then you have statutes reviving by implication. And I only throw this out here, and it can get a little bit confusing, but that's one of the criticisms, and these are the main ones I hear all the time, and there's absolutely no basis for them. And when you go back, and again, you look at that Carhart decision, you say, is this the court that we want to bring this case before? Absolutely. Are we going to wait another 37 years for what? The other says, well, we don't support a state human life amendment. We support a federal constitutional amendment. I support a federal constitutional amendment. Where is it? Where is a federal constitutional amendment? These same people who are the naysayers for personhood and state personhood amendments, well, we ought to, you know, put all our efforts in the federal constitutional amendment. Beautiful, bring it on. As I say before, it's exceedingly difficult to amend the federal constitution. Exceedingly difficult. States have far more lenient ways of amending the state constitution, and you're establishing that same principle that you want to go right at the core of Roe versus Wade. And then finally, I hear this one all the time, well, you're disregarding the mother. Oh, we need to have an exception for the life of the mother. It's not true. One thing you got to keep in mind is when you recognize the personhood of the unborn, that doesn't mean now that we ignore the personhood of the mother. And what I always think about is in our present context, when you take things out of the abortion context, remove the abortion from it, that's where the law is right now. When my wife went in to have our 11th child, if there was some serious physical if there was some serious medical problem that had occurred during the course of that, the doctor is required to use his best medical skill to protect both of those lives. And unfortunately, it doesn't always work out. One of the lives may not make it. But outside the abortion context, that's the way it is now. Our gynecologist is terrific. He's NFP only. He's totally pro-life. Doesn't press any of these, you know, these culture of death procedures on my wife. And I know he would do everything he could to save both lives if anything had occurred. So to say that we don't respect the life of mother, that's nonsense. What was it before 1973? You had complicated pregnancies. That happens. But we can deal with that. You deal with that by having the doctors understand, and they do understand by and large, that you have two lives that you're dealing with. The only time you don't is you have an abortion doctor who thinks he can, you know, it's okay to stab the scissors in the back of the head of the child. I mean, you think about that late-term abortion, right? You've got to do one of the most dangerous things, do a breech delivery of a child. Number one reason is because the child may have a cleft palate. That's a medical necessity. It's all nonsense. So recognizing the personhood of the unborn doesn't mean that we ignore the personhood of the mother. One of the other comments that comes up is about enabling legislation. Do we need enabling legislation? And that's essentially, well, a constitutional amendment doesn't enact any particular law. By having a constitutional amendment, we're trying to establish a principle, a principle that transcends all legislation. Right now, the only barrier, the main barrier to having legislation, specific legislation, to deal with all these life issues is Roe versus Wade. We've got to get rid of that constitutional principle, that structure that we have right now that promotes the culture of death. We've got to shatter that and create a new principle, a new concept. And granted, it may only be at the state level, but we're going to fight it state by state by state. And then hopefully at some point we can have that federal constitutional amendment. Or perhaps, even better, nobody will ever consider abortion. So it doesn't matter. Make the law meaningless. In my household, it's meaningless. When we have a child, it's not like, well, what does Roe versus Wade say? What can we do? What can't we do? No, we're going to have a child. So an amendment will remove that main obstacle. Also, in constitutional amendments, you can put in a provision that allows a legislature to pass legislation pursuant to that. The 14th Amendment has it. Section 5 of the 14th Amendment has an enabling provision that allows Congress to pass laws. The reason why we have the Civil Rights Act, for example, it's grounded in the authority in the 14th Amendment. And just wrap this up in conclusion. Planned Parenthood, NARAL, ACLU, they all fear what we're afraid to do. Everywhere these human life amendments, personhood amendments show up in the states, they have teams of lawyers coming in to defeat them. If it's such a bad idea, then why is that the case? Because they understand. They understand those realities. They listened loud and clear to Ginsburg's dissent, that this court is primed to overturn Roe versus Wade. What will the next generation say about our unwillingness to test this court with a direct challenge to Roe versus Wade? Got to ask yourself that question. Because time is now. And again, it's always the right time to do the right thing, even if it's just to educate the American public even more about abortion, then it's the right thing to do. But I think it's the right time now because it's the time to overturn Roe versus Wade, and we have a court that is willing to do so. This last quote is from, I think it's Wayne Gretzky. You miss 100% of the shots you don't take. We got to take that shot. Personhood needs to be the main effort of the pro-life movement. From educating the American public, to when you're marching out there tomorrow morning and afternoon, to creating a framework, a legal framework that promotes the culture of life. And thank you very much for your attention today.